together until about 7:30. My name is Guy Kahulukukui, the director of the Department of Enterprise Services. Enterprise Services is a city department that oversees this particular venue, the Blaisdell Center, including the arena, the meeting rooms, the exhibition hall, the concert hall, as well as what Michelle, Honolulu Zoo, and our city golf courses, and the city's concessions. So it's a wide-ranging department. I'm hosting the presentation, and we're holding it here because I think, as you might have heard or read in the paper today, the city is in the process of transferring the operational control from the Department of Parks and Recreation to the Department of Enterprise Services, and I wanted to give you the opportunity to hear what our thinking is behind that move. Additionally, this is our chance to share, to do two things relative to the Palm Square Master Plan. One is to give you an update of the pending construction or pending renovation at Thomas Square, the first phase. This is really the culmination of a phase that started with public meetings and public hearings and the collection of information back in 2014. Construction should be starting in August, but we'll get into that a little bit later. So it's two things. One is to give you an update on what's going to happen more or less immediately, as well as give you some background on the next 2 to 3 phases and collect some input from you on the next 2 to 3 phases. And one thing to keep in mind, that the, basically what the phases do is they sequentially allow us to restore in a greater way, to a greater degree, Thomas Square and put the luster back on it. Thomas Square has not had a significant upgrade or renovation since 1967. This would be, the city is right now poised to contribute and invest a significant amount of money into its upgrade to put its luster back and restore it and honor its history. We'll also have the opportunity to discuss its history a little bit. If you haven't already done so when you came in, I suggest you do pick up a reprint from the Hawaii Journal of History. It's a great little piece written by Richard Greer, who was a noted local historian. And he did a very nice job of doing the history of Thomas Square. It also includes at the back a rendition of the present version of the final master plan. So first, the transfer from Parks and Recreation to the Enterprise Services. The primary reason to do this transfer is that we're located right across the street from Thomas Square. On our campus, we have a building services department or division, as well as a customer services division. We're going to be able to maintain the park after it reopens at a higher level of quality than the Department of Parks and Recreation has been able to commit resources to. And it's not for a lack of their effort, it's just a matter of we have folks right here, right across the street, all the equipment that's necessary. We can be in Thomas Square on a daily basis doing maintenance. The other thing that we'll be able to do through our customer services division is we plan to pilot what we're right now calling sort of a concierge service at Thomas Square, where we will, during the day, have an employee there to assist park users, to also share the history of the park with park users, and to do everything we can to encourage more use by the general public, as well as ongoing permitted use. Which is an important point to make. All of the existing uses authorized under permit by the Department of Parks and Recreation will continue under the Department of Enterprise Services. So all the entities that have who have been able to get a permit in the past will be able to authorize it, be authorized for the same use going into the future. There may be additional uses. We will, as a department, have to go through the administrative rule process to develop additional rules so that we can apply them at the park and have them enforced at the park. I can tell you that a rulemaking process involves a public hearing, which we very likely would have right back in this setting where we can get input from the community on rules that we're hoping to promulgate. Our intention is to start with the park's rules, look at what they allow and what they disallow, determine how that fits with some of our plans to do additional programming in the park, and then enhance the rules, and then bring the package first to the neighboring neighborhood boards so we can get that input, into the rules before we have a public hearing and go through that process. All of that should take place in the period of time that the park is closed, so that by the time it reopens, which right now is scheduled for sometime in February 2017, and we'll get into that in greater detail, when it reopens, we would expect to have the new rules package in place. We'll have had the opportunity to get community input on it and to communicate back out into the community some of the sort of enhanced uses that we're talking about. And when I talk about enhanced uses, really what we're looking at is creating a venue at Thomas Square that is the premier location in the city to hold cultural festivals and events. That's really what we want to see. We have a plan of creating an annual calendar of programs that would happen in there. So events such as Intertribal Powwow, which happens there right now, we're really encouraging those folks to be part of our annual calendar. Kalahoehoe'ea, that's Restoration Day event, will continue in there. That'll be a significant part of our calendar. We're looking at creating two new events that celebrate the arrival and the departure of the Kolea. We'd like to host that there. The Manu'oku, the ferry tern, is the official bird of the city and county of Honolulu. This year marked its first annual event. It was at Iolani Palace. We would like to move that to Thomas Square. So it's these sorts of things that we would like to have happen on a monthly basis, and hopefully at some point on a weekly basis. For instance, trying to bring the Royal Hawaiian Band back for a weekly performance in Thomas Square, a place where they were actually born. It's really an exciting potential opportunity for us. That being said, our department, Enterprise Services, is really in a better position to service those types of events. If you had an event at Thomas Square permitted by the Department of Parks and Recreation, then you know basically it's a passive permit. You come in with your requests, it's permittable under their rules and their ordinance. You conduct your event largely without any support. The kind of support that you see just in here for this public meeting is the kind of support we can bring to events over at Thomas Square. In addition, because it is a Department of Enterprise Services event, parking is going to be available for all of these types of festivals and ethnic events that we envision for Thomas Square. So we really see the master plan as an opportunity to create the venue that can really host these programmed events in a way that the square right now has a difficult time doing. Everything that we want to do is intended to increase and enhance the use of Thomas Square by the general public, as well as create opportunities for the community to, under a permit, use it for their significant cultural and significant cultural events. What I'd like to do, if you don't mind, is ask you to hold your questions to the end. Our presentation is only gonna run about 30 minutes, maybe 40 minutes, and after that, the rest of the time, I will be available to answer questions, as well as me, if I can introduce, and if you don't know him already, Chris Davis is the project manager who's been working on this for a few years now. We're gonna take turns on this presentation, and he will also be available to answer questions as we go forward. So if I can introduce Chris, he's gonna take you through the phases of the master plan, and then we'll open up for questions, so thank you.
Good evening. I'm going to go through the history of Thomas Square a little bit, because that's one of the main reasons we're working on this project. And the history is all within this book. So if you got this book, you can certainly read this and get more details from the book than I'll present today. But I'll give you an overview so you understand the context of what we're doing in the park. So Thomas Square, the beginning of Thomas Square goes back to a gentleman by the name of Richard Charlton, who in 1825 was the British consul for Great Britain. And he established a consul on a street on the edge of town, which they ended up calling Baritania Street in the end. He was a bit of a troublemaker. He was kind of known as, I think historians said, he was foul-mouthed, obtuse, and rough. And he tried to secure a piece of land down on the harbor. And unfortunately, he dealt with the wrong person, and he felt like he got the raw end of the deal. So he was very mad, and he ended up instigating the conflict when Paulette came. He got other British landowners to also get together, and 34 of them basically went to the British government and said, we need our rights wrong, our wrongs righted, and the Hawaiian government's not taking care of it. So they sent in Paulette. And Paulette came to Hawaii in 1843, in February, and he demanded that King Kamehameha III restore these properties that had been, that they felt they'd wrongly got the resolution they wanted. And so at that time, King Kamehameha III said that the process was fair and just, and that he was not going to reverse the decisions done by the kingdom. So at that point, Paulette took over the government. And during a reign of 5 months, Paulette destroyed all the flags in the state, destroyed some of the symbols of the government. At that time, King Kamehameha III sent an emissary to the British government, and Queen Victoria herself ended up telling King Kamehameha III, through a representative, that the government should be restored. And so Victoria authorized Admiral Thomas to go back to Hawaii and turn the kingdom back over to the Hawaiian kingdom. So at that point, the next slide. At that point, in 1843, on July 31st was the actual day. It was, I think, 5 days after Admiral Thomas landed and had some conversations with King Kamehameha III, that they decided that they would have the official ceremony. And at that time, they wanted to have it on the edge of town. So the edge of town at that time was where Thomas Square is. This was the edge of town. And so the British soldiers came, and they set up their tents, and they set up early in the morning, and then the Hawaiian military, they came and set up, and then King Kamehameha III came in last. And they signed some papers that was a proclamation for restoring the government. At that time, the British flag was taken down, and the Hawaiian flag was raised. At that time, in 1843, there were a couple different versions of the Hawaiian flag that different people used. And so the actual version of the flag they used on that day is the flag that we now use as our state flag. But in 1850, King Kamehameha III made it the official flag of the kingdom first. So the flag that we fly today is a result of what happened partially at Thomas Square. The other important event that happened that day was King Kamehameha III, after signing the proclamation, raising and lowering the flags, he then went to the stone church at Kawaihao. At that time, he said the state motto, which became our state motto. And if you look at the context of that, the context is a little bit different than our current interpretation. Oftentimes, we say the life of the land, but in context of the event that took place, it's about sovereignty. It's the sovereignty of the land. So when you look at the context of our state motto, it's actually a little different, but come to that understanding when you think about what actually took place at Thomas Square. But there's a lot more history to the square than just that. That's the most important part of the history, but the history goes on. So in 1850, 7 years after the restoration, King Kamehameha III has the Privy Council, which is a set of advisors, designate the actual parcel of property as Thomas Square. And they put two granite pier anchors in the corners of the property, and that becomes the boundaries. And that was the first park in our islands, was Thomas Square. And in context, so you kind of understand the how progressive King Kamehameha III was, it was the 38th park in the whole United States. So 38, it was the 38th park. So King Kamehameha III was a visionary in so many ways, but obviously he was way ahead of the times. So moving a little forward, and later in 1850, that was the first restoration event. Unfortunately, King Kamehameha III got sick and the event was canceled, but the very first restoration event was in 1850. In 1887, they decided, this is 37 years after they made it a park, they decided to actually improve the park. And they get Archibald Cleghorn, who's Princess Caroline's father, to design the park. He becomes the first park commissioner of the kingdom. And working with the city engineer, Robert Sterling, they design a new park. And they open it April 7th, I think, 1887, and the Royal Hawaiian Band plays there. And they end up playing there for about 3 or 4 decades every Wednesday at the park. And that's some of the context of the Royal Hawaiian Band, which also had its roots in Thomas Square, which Most people are aware probably that Royal Line Band was also created by King Kamehameha III. In 1907, the University of Hawaii opened its first building. They took over a house called the Marston House. The Marston House was where Lenacona is. And that's where they were a land-grant college. And that they started a, I think it was an agricultural school, was the first school, because a lot of land-grant colleges were agricultural schools. And so that also was born on Thomas Square. In 1927, the Museum of Arts opens, the Academy, and becomes one of the major art institutions on our island. In 1964, the Concert Hall opens, which is right behind us here. And in 1989, the art school opens at Lenacona, or 1990, I think the museum took over in 1987. They fixed up the building because it's sort of fallen in disrepair. So you can see from this history that there are so many things that touch us today, whether it's the state motto, which I think when people say that motto, I mean, it's something everyone takes great pride in. It's something that makes you feel really proud about being in the islands. It's when you, that motto, and that came from this square and this event. And the flag, when you see the flag, that's what, you know, it gives you a sense of pride. And so these things, that's why the square is so important. I mean, these are things that made our state partly what it is, and today, the imagery and who we are. So I'm going to go a little bit through the progression of the park itself. And if these pictures are a little bit blurry, which I think they might be washed up, they're also on the back of this book. So you can look at the back of the book. So the first square on the far left is when the park was just grass. And it was the edge of town. It had the two grand pillars on each corner that designated the actual square. At that time, they used it for agricultural purposes. So they planted jute, they planted kiawe, they planted oats, they planted different things to test it out. And that's what it was used as back in the 1840s, 1850s, 1860s. 1887 was when Cleghorn came through. He took cuttings from the banyan tree at Ainahau, the Indian banyan tree. That you see the famous pictures of Princess Kailani sitting in a tree, I think it was with Mark Twain or Stevenson. So those actual cuttings, he took four cuttings, and those are the four banyan trees that surround the mountain. And that's the only thing that's original from that design. Everything else in the square changed in the next design. But those four banyan trees were part of that design. And they're basically from 1887, those banyan trees are that old. In the middle of the banyan trees was a bandstand. And that's where the Royal Hawaiian Band played. And if you look at old newspapers, like on a Thursday newspaper, it'll say what happened at the Wednesday concert, usually. How many drunks there were, what songs they played, and so forth. The park continued to get a lot of people planted trees there, just like they did at Foster and Lion Arboretum. This park, for some reason, people kept planting new species. But in 1932, and McCoy becomes the commissioner of parks, the same fellow who McCoy Pavilion is named after. He hires a husband and wife team, Thompson and Thompson. And the wife, Kathleen Richards, also designed the courtyards of the art museum prior, like, I think in 1927, 1926. And so the same landscape architect designed the courtyards at the museum. She was hired by McCoy with her husband to do Thomas Square, and they also did Alamona Park at the same time. So all these parks are being developed at the same time. At that time, the husband and wife totally changed the whole project. They removed everything except those four banyans. And they put the fountain in the middle. And at that time, they were looking for some money. So they asked the Outdoor Circle, and the Outdoor Circle came through and they donated money for the fountain. And they paid for that fountain at that time. It was named after one of their presidents, Beatrice Castle, who was one of the most influential Outdoor Circle presidents of their 100 years. So the only thing that's left is the four banyans, and at that time they put in the pass system. It almost looks like the British Jack, but the pass has some curves to it. That design stays the same way for 35 more years, and then George Walters, another famous local landscape architect, comes around. He straightens out the pass. And at that time, 67, That's when the pass looked like the British Jack, when you look at them from an aerial photo or a Google map. And that's the birth of that pattern with the British Jack. There's the British Jack up in the top right. Also, famous Ossipoff architect Tom Wells designs the bathroom and the structure next to it, if you remember Ossipoff. So this is the first project that's gone out to bid. It's a simple project. It's a grass, irrigation, and soil amendments. That's all it is. Nothing else changes in the project. There are no new trees, there's no new benches, there's no new sidewalks. All it is grass and irrigation. Typically, we do these projects it seems a simple maintenance project. And so that's what's going on to bid this time. It's a very straightforward project. Now, the master plan is why we started arranging these meetings. The reason why we're here tonight, the reason why we had a meeting last Monday, was to share the master plan, which is going to go through a couple different phases. So I'm going to start off on King Street and talk a little bit about King Street and some of the improvements that are going to happen on King Street. So King Street was originally called MOI, M-O-I. If you look at old maps, the oldest maps of our city, back in the 1700s, 1800s, King Street is not King Street, it's MOI. M-O-K-I, and that means the highest of the E. And they ended up changing the name to King Street, but that is the root of that name of that street. And that's where King Kamehameha the first statue ends up going, going later. So on King Street, as it passes through the park, what we'd like to do is we'd like to honor King Kamehameha the third. I mean, when you think about it, at this park, he restores the government, he decides what flag it ends up being the flag we all identify with today. He says the state motto. I mean, it seems like this is a really good place to honor King Kamehameha III. There's no other statue of King Kamehameha III anywhere in our state. So this is the very first one. And I'm proud to say that we have put out a request is going out tomorrow, I think, for a designer. It's an open process. It's a request for qualifications, and the qualifications are due, I think, October 2nd. And so that statue is going to start looking for artists for that statue. And it'll be a bronze. It'll probably look a lot like some of the other bronze. It'll look very similar. So we're looking at a statue in a plaza on King Street, and you can see that in the middle of the sidewalk. To the right of that is sort of a circle, and that's where we're putting the Hawaiian flag. And so this park will be one of the only sites in the whole state where only the Hawaiian flag flies. We're not flying any other flag here. That's it. We'll take questions at the end. So the flag is going to be a historical flagpole. It's going to be the same height as the flagpole at Yaleina Palace, which is about the same time period, which is 40 feet. The actual dimensions of the flag will be the official dimensions of your ship flag flags, which will be 6 feet tall, 10 feet long. You can imagine driving or walking down King Street, seeing King Kamehameha III on some sort of pedestal, and seeing the Hawaiian flag flying behind him. It should be a special experience. The other improvements that we show here is we show a lot of coconuts, which is a canoe plant. And it's also representative of what happens across the street in this old Ward State property, which has become the Blaisdell. And so we're having some continuity on the Thomas Square side of the street. And next slide. So on Ward Ave was named after Curtis Perry Ward. He was a Southerner who came to Hawaii and married Mrs. Robinson. And that was the beginning of the Ward State, but it's actually named after the gentleman from the South. Now on this street, it's a very noisy street. I mean, all these, Thomas Square is on the three busiest streets in our city, probably, more or less, I mean, besides Nimitz. But you got Ward Street, you got Barrett Tanney, you got King. These are really busy streets. But the difference is, on Ward Street, there's tall buildings, and the noise really bounces off into the park. So on this side of the park, we're planting two rows of trees. We're planting planting strip, and we're moving the sidewalk away from the street so you can kind of walk down a row of trees with under the trees and there'll be benches and so forth, so it'll be a little bit more inviting. And this picture here is a picture that kind of has that look of the two rows of trees in the path. Like I said, Baritania was named after Richard Charlton, who created this whole conflict in the first place. I mean, he manufactured this conflict with Paul Abercrombie. But Baritania means Britain. On this street, at the moment, we show a wide sidewalk with the two rows of trees again. And we show the stairs, which are narrow, widening. So we're taking the Daughters of White Plaque, we're putting it exactly in the same place, but a little further over to the right. So we're creating a little wider walkway so you can walk down the stairs. We show at the moment a performance area, but we're still getting public comments on that. That may or may not be there in the end, but at the moment, that's the location that has the least amount of sound. We took sound readings around the square, and that was the best location. But if people don't want it, or if people want it, we'll figure that out, and we'll go forward with that at that time. On this slide. So Victoria Street was named after Queen Victoria, who actually issued the orders to Admiral Thomas to restore the government. And so Victoria Street was named after her, and she influenced a long period of time. The Victorian design became really popular. On this street, we're putting a single row of trees along there, and we're fixing up the bathroom. And so one of the things that Guy mentioned was a concierge, and so we envisioned the concierge taking care of those bathrooms and making them safe and clean, keeping them clean more often. So I know that's something that different council folks, members have asked us to do, but this park we're actually able to do it because we have staff right next door. So this will probably be the first park in our whole city where there'll be someone in the bathroom on Saturdays and Sundays and sometimes during the week. And then the middle of the park, that's the famous picture of Princess Caroline and the banyan tree at Brenhouse City. But we're protecting those banyan trees, of course. I mean, we're leaving them the way they are. We're going to do some paving in there. At the moment, it's just sort of rubble, but we're going to make it ADA compliant. So we're going to make it smoother. And then we're going to uplight the trunks of the banyan trees a little bit to show off the beautiful banyan trees in the square. The fountain, we're going to restore to the 1932 design. So we're going to keep it the same way. We're going to make it original. Lastly, next slide. So I'm just going to walk through some of the historic, people say, well, what exactly are you doing from a historic angle? So I want to kind of reiterate these points. The yellow parts are where there's something being done different than the moment. The white parts is what's original. So when you look at it, we're changing the perimeter of the property a little bit to improve it. The middle of the park stays the same. So you can see that the park is mostly the way it is at the moment. Next up. We're flying only the Hawaiian flag. We're putting on a historic-sized flagpole. And we're doing the correct dimension, 6x10, for a flagpole that's 40 feet tall. And so this will be one of the only spots, I think, in the county, the city county, Honolulu flies only a Hawaiian flag. There's only a couple of spots in the whole state. I think there's only three spots. Three. So this is the third. And this is this should have been the first one. I mean, like I mentioned, tomorrow there'll be some media talking about King Kamehameha III statue. And this is gonna be a bronze, and it'll go through the Art Commission, and there'll be opportunities for the public to comment on it. And October 2nd is the date where the final date where people have to put in their qualifications. The Royal Hawaiian Band, they were created in 1936, but the park was in 1887, and they played here for about 30, 40 years. I'm not sure the exact time period, but they played here every Wednesday, and it became a very popular place. And so we'd like to bring them back to Thomas Square to continue to play. Next slide. So I've talked about the history of the park. The park has got such a rich history. It's got the flag, the restoration.
No, we're gonna break away for a second.
They're gonna arrest me.
Well, I'll cover you.
Cover that then.
Right now, the only storytelling you have going on.
Who's gonna arrest?
The daughters of AY and Blackers. Gotta be one of you, plaques, in our whole city. If you ever look at this plaque, it's worth it. But we'd like to tell that story. A lot of people, I mean, the three busy streets, 100,000 people drive by this park every day, there's one on the street.
I'm gonna see what's up here, following Kiana outside.
This is enforcement of security, what will happen at Thomas Square. People being hassled.
Okay, let's see what's happening here. Oh, this isn't police.
This is a prime example.
But she's taking photos of me specifically.
It's just like if you're standing on the sidewalk, you're in a public place. So they're really,
you can ask some black people to take a picture of you, but.
I did erase the one he asked me to, but he ain't taking my camera.
Yeah, but I want your camera.
I don't want to get into a big issue.
No, there's no issue. I'm trying to explain that. We're in a public venue, so cameras are allowed.
Yeah, this is what's going to happen in Thomas Square, everybody.
This is what's going to happen.
Okay, Kiana was taking pictures and I was approached apparently by the private security person.
So you guys go back to filming, you're fine.
Okay, well there's a... We're trying to document...
I'm at a meeting.
Yeah.
I'm attending a public meeting.
You understand that, but... There goes just a misunderstanding. You're perfectly allowed to take your cameras inside.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just like when the news media is filming somebody on a sidewalk, they may ask.
Exactly.
Not to
I'm shot all the time without my consent and without my approval.
Yeah, but you folks are fine.
But thank you. Okay. Thank you.
As you were.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
We got that kind of resolve, maybe because city people were here.
Yeah.
Let's see what. Blaisdell guy.
I'm good.
Apparently mayor.
Mayor staff. Looks like it. You can tell. Wait, the one on the right?
One on the right is the Blaisdell guy. He's the guy, he's the administrator.
Okay.
And we have HPD in the dark uniform and security must be, I didn't read the logos, but they don't have my glasses. Okay, and we've established this is a public meeting and that we can continue to stream, so let me break away and come back. Can you repeat the question?
The question was council's meeting tomorrow, when we expect them to approve the budget, then send it to the mayor. And if,
no, I didn't say you expect them to approve. I said if there should be a change in the budget, how would it affect your master plan?
Okay, thank you. So the question is, if there was a change in the budget, how would it affect our master plan? In essence, there already is a change in the budget. We had a budget request in for fiscal 2017 in an amount that was not approved. However, there is fiscal 16 money that can be used next year, about $1.5 million. So we have no problem funding the first phase, which is the soil and the irrigation. And we'll need to look at our phase two components of the master plan and reprioritize what we wanted to do so that we can do the things that we can afford I believe it's about $1.5 million of work in phase two can be afforded at this moment. So it would get us a little off of our schedule, but we would still have some enhancements going in after the grass and after the irrigation. If we can.
Can you explain to us why these some of the members of the city council are opposed to this?
You know, we've had an opportunity to talk with, well, the question was, can we explain why some of the members of the city council are opposed to it? I know we had the opportunity to brief Councilmember Kobayashi and her staff, as well as Councilmember Fukunaga and her staff, and as well as Councilmember Pine and her staff. And the first two council members were selected because their districts kind of border our area right here, and Councilmember Pine oversees Parks and Recreation for the council. My understanding is from what they shared with us personally, and also what I read in the newspaper, is they had some concerns over our communication with the community over phase one. And the phase one, as I started off by saying, started in about 2014 with community meetings. That predates me, but I believe Chris was participated in those. And now, 2 years later, we're getting to the point where construction is beginning. And I think there was some concern that we didn't communicate well enough in that 2 year period as we were getting closer to the point where we would close the park to do construction. Yes.
Okay, my concern is that, yeah, you're gonna put up a lot of improvements over there and you're gonna expand upon the issue of Thomas Square. Very nice, kind of like dead things. We have been celebrating La Hoi Hoi Ea for the last 40 years at Thomas Square, okay? And we do it without the support of the city or anybody else. This year, La Hoi Hoi Ea falls on a Sunday, and we were told that we cannot use Thomas Square on July 31st, but construction is not gonna be into August. We don't have any place to go. Iolani Palace was suggested, and my understanding is that there's a $4,000 fee for using that place. Why? If nothing's going to happen at Thomas Square, why cannot we hold La Hoi Hoi Ea, observe the living event that we've been doing for the last 40 years? Right. Why can't we do it there? And if nobody's has a permit, then I'm right here, right now, I'm asking for the permit for Thomas Square to observe La Hoi Hoi Ea, which we've done for the last 40 years. Other issues, your nice presentation, but you got a lot of errors inside there. Okay, you're not talking about the Hawaiian flag. Hai Hawaii is not U.S. flag code. U.S. flag code is 3x5. Hai Hawaii was established by the legislature of the kingdom as being a 1-to-2 ratio. And that's what they fly at Iolani Palace. They don't fly U.S. flag code flags. 6x10 is U.S. flag code. That's a state flag. The flag of Kauikeaouli was 6x12. And that's what they fly at Iolani Palace. You got numerous errors on top of that thing, and maybe you need to correct it or something. But again, if nobody has a permit for La Hoi Hoi Ea July 31st, I'm asking for it right now.
Well, we can answer that. I'll actually let Ms. Dikalai, Executive Director of Mayor's Office of Culture and Arts.
Aloha mai, my name is Ms. Dikalai, Executive Director of the Mayor's Office of Culture and the Arts. When I came on board, when Kirk Caldwell came on board in 2013, July 31st, we did celebrate the first La Hoi Hoi Ea for city government. I've been working with Imai Kalani Winchester for the past 3 years. I've been in contact with him constantly. Mayor has approved La Hoi Hoi Ea will happen at Thomas Square July 30th and 31st. The paperwork is in. Imai is asking for city co-sponsorship, first time ever, to have a lot of things that other ethnic groups apply and receive that La Hoi Hoi Ea has never applied for city co-sponsorship, and we have encouraged Imai to do so. So we are helping him, and it's gonna be really good. So La Hoi Hoi Ea will be not a one-day event this year, it's a two-day event, July 30th and 31st, and yes, we are working with Imai Winchester and Aina Momona, Hui Aina Momona.
Let me respond to that. You know, we're talking actually about two La Hoi Hoi Ea, because they're the ones that has been happening since 86 or 87 that was started by Kikuni Blaisdell, yes, and the Trask sisters. And that's the one I'm talking about. The Baron does, and it'd be great when they have a flagpole. They bring their own. But there's also a fake Lahoihoia that Kirk Caldwell has that's open just to invited guests. The one Baron has, anybody can come. Anybody is welcome. The one that Kirk Caldwell has, I show up, I get threatened to be arrested. And I have that on video, which is why I keep the video on things. Which one? Okay, it's a big difference. The whole city sponsorship kind of thing, I'm really suspicious of, because that sounds like
you
the other one.
The organizer, he might Winchester, because
I'm just bringing this up. It's grounds for my suspicion and distrust of the city and the city's motivations for doing this.
Okay, appreciate your comments, and certainly, sir, appreciate your comments in particular about the flag, and certainly we will also look into them in the Mayor's Office of Culture and Arts. We actually do have someone who's very knowledgeable, and we will share this information with them, so thank you. Another question. Yes?
Yeah, I love the statue idea. Is that the principal cost after phase one? And then the second question is, on aesthetics, I don't see any flowers whatsoever. Is that intentional?
Well, a master plan is a general document. The actual details happen in a construction document design phase, so that we'll have more opportunities for the public to comment. And so there will be flowers in this park, but we're not showing them long, but we're thinking that we're putting them probably around the statue and around the flagpole and also along Baritania, along the street there. So we're looking at, this will be one of the few parks that actually has flowers, because it is a higher maintenance item.
Sure.
So.
The statue?
The statue is, right now it's $250,000 for the design and the fabrication and the pedestal. And answering the question about the flag is that we actually talked, there's a couple of vexillologists in the state. Vexillologists are folks who study flags and flag experts. And we actually consulted one. He was the one who gave us the recommendation on the flag size. We didn't determine that ourselves.
All right, go to the back of the room. I'll take the first part and then we'll come to you.
Mine is kind of related to that.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. According to that master plan, what kind of trees are you going to plant? Because there's not enough room for like trees like that, the way you have it, you know? If you're just going to deal with the edges of the park, they got to be pretty small trees, you know, the double rows of trees, and it doesn't seem to, like, is that all the way to
Okay, thank you. I think we can take up both of those. I'll take the first part. And so just for clarification, you know, phase one, the part that's going to start very soon, irrigation, new grass, is fully funded. Phase two is partially funded. And your question is, why would we start if we have only partial funding? Well, in essence, the city's budgeting process is done on an annual basis. We have up to 2 years to expend the CIP. We're confident in the broader conversations that we've had with the council that we're moving in the right direction. So rather than not do anything at all in phase two, I do believe it's a better strategy to prioritize what we thought we wanted to do in phase two if we had all of our funding and do the most important parts, come back to the city where there'll be oversight on our request again in the next fiscal year. And you know, if we do a good job, which I believe we will do, I expect that we can have the funding restored and we continue to move through the stages. I'll take up the next part.
So the second question was about the interior and exterior of the park. So the interior park actually is done first. So to answer Albert's question, the whole interior of the park will be redone with grass and new irrigation, and we're putting in Azorcha El Toro grass, which is probably the nicest grass that will go in any city park in this city. And we can do that because Enterprise Services operates the golf courses. They have experts on grass and irrigation, more so than any other department. So we're gonna have one of the nicest grasses to lay on, sleep on, sit on, have events on. And so the whole center of the park gets redone. To answer Albert's question, the banyan trees get protected, the paving around the banyan trees is made ADA compliant, the paths, the bridge paths get redone, all the grass irrigation gets redone, but it's not the same as what it looks like now. That's what I was mentioning about the difference between what's historically being protected and what the borders are being changed a little bit. And so, the whole park gets upgraded, but the center of the park is going to get restored to its original, the way it looked in 1932 and 1967, those two improvements. And the tree species. Most of the trees in this project are going to be native trees. So we're looking at native and canoe plants for the whole park, and we're going to do our best to do that. All the trees in the park more or less stay there. There are a few that fall into what's new paving areas, and so we may be removing those, but most of every tree that can be saved is going to be saved in this project.
Go ahead, please.
Hi, Lee. You know, in regards to a lot of the questions, I really appreciate your question, because that was real good, in regards to correcting and then in there again. A lot of the questions that are being directed at this meeting has a lot to do with people questioning what is going on now. As far as the city council is concerned, as like anything, it's budget, there's timelines, there's time dates, there's each and every one of us should know that in regards to when it comes to money. And the bottom line too, if you really look at that master plan per se, right there it says this is a draft for public comment. So all the questions here are very important to everyone here, but to make sure that we all understand when it comes to budgets, things do change, plants, whatever, trees, everything that you're doing right now, as far as I'm concerned, I am looking at this as an educated session. This is to let us know exactly what you're heading for and what you're trying to do. We're thinking about the past, the present, and we're going to lead this into the future. I thank you for this. This is an education for you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. The design is intended, and maybe Chris, you can speak to this a little bit more in terms of the trees. It's a high canopy. The design is intended to encourage access to the park from all directions. We want people to cut through the park and not go around it, which a lot of people are doing right now. I think, I'm not sure we answered all of your questions. Let Chris take the next part.
You talk about the concept of
First, I would clarify that that's not the sole purpose of the concierge. We expect that having a person there is going to help in terms of the overall maintenance and appropriate use of the restroom. So the restrooms will, at least as part of the initial phase, be clean, maintained, be serviceable, and be safe. That's our goals. The concierge is there to have people feel safe, not just at the restrooms, but all through the park. Well, there's at the moment we operate under parks rules, and there's certain things that are permitted or allowable while the park is open anyway under parks rules. So one of the things I said earlier, what we will have to do is establish rules for enterprise services that actually will be enforced all the way across our campus, the 22 acres that we're on right now, as well as the 6 acres over there. And that rulemaking process is a public process, so that's one where we will be getting additional public input. I appreciate your patience. Thank you.
Another question. You say native trees you planted, are they endemic trees or indigenous?
Most of the trees in nursery production are indigenous. Very few are endemic. The one endemic tree we are planting at this project is Pachardium mardii, which is the native palm to the Kolau Range. That's the only endemic tree that we can have in production at the moment. If you're aware of other endemic trees that are in production in nurseries, I'd be more than happy to look into them.
Also, one more question. You said 30 parks. Thomas Square was 34 in America.
It changes. But last time I checked, it was 34, 38. I think it changed the last couple of years. But
Thomas Square, when it was a park, was not part of America.
Correct.
It was not an American
Correct.
Park. It's a Hawaiian park.
I'm just mentioning it, comparing it to the United States. If you compare it to that, it would be the 38th or 34th, depending on what year you look at.
I have a question. Are you planting just flowers, or are you planting food as well? Are you planting color?
Good question.
As I mentioned earlier, the only thing that we were definitely doing is the Pachardium mardii. The other plants are going to be indigenous and endemic. I think that would be up for discussion. We probably should do that, but we haven't worked out those details. I'd be more than happy to talk to you about that further if you have other ideas.
Thank you very much.
Sam?
Yeah. Biggest problem I see on this is the grass planting taking 4 to 6 months. What I think you should do is make sod pre-planted and put it up and eliminate the amount of time that the park is shut down, because 6 months for that park being shut down is going to cause a lot of controversy. If you could do it in 1 month, I think people would live with it, but 6 months to shut down to take the grass is kind of crazy. Also, the planters on the outside, if you could eliminate that, that has always been a contention to the neighborhood boards. Because it's not big enough for the sidewalk. They actually damaged the sidewalk when they put those things in, and they didn't get authority from the state. They just kind of did it without getting permission from the state, because it is considered a historic area. And I think that needs to be fixed first before you look at anything else.
Okay, and thank you. We'll take them, I think, in reverse order.
Yeah.
As I said earlier, the planters, we can't commit to this the phase, but the planters do come out, and they have to come out because we want easy access.
Right.
We want access from every single street. We want as many people cutting through the park as possible, and we don't want to create barriers to that. The other part, in terms of the sod, I know that was something that was considered earlier on, and I believe the decision that was made to go this route was a cost consideration. We'll let Chris take it up.
So the sod would be about 50% more cost than we have at the moment for the project, so it'd be about 50% higher. And so we did look into it. It was something that we considered and something I would have liked to have done, but it was going to be costly.
Yes, in the back, please.
I was just wondering, since this is a historic park, if you folks have gone through the Historic Preservation Division and the Advisory Council on Historic Preservation, and if you're doing the 106 process, and if you've even attempted anything. I haven't heard anything about that.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
We have met with Shifty at least twice, and we've also met with the Historic Hawaii Foundation twice. This process is going through the environmental assessment process for this project, and that process will probably start in the next couple of months.
Okay, if you're going to close the park and you're going to do renovations, you really can't until the EIS is completed, right? That's the point of an environmental impact statement, is to see the impact that your disruption is going to cause the environment. Is that not correct?
As far as the EA requirement, the EA is required for substantial improvements. The grass irrigation is typically considered a maintenance project by the environmental process, so it does not require.
But irrigation does not, actually.
But the improvements we show on this plan with the trees and the benches and the sidewalks, that does require EA. And that is why that work is not, none of that work is taking place in phase one.
Okay, so actually you're starting the process without the approval of EI. EIS.
We're doing the parts of the project that do not require an EA process according to
Shifty. Because everything is in draft status, right? So you're allowed to just, it doesn't really exist because we're in draft. Is that true?
Grass irrigation is considered a maintenance project by the environmental process. It's not considered a construction project.
Yes.
Yes. I've lived in the neighborhood for 32 years. 15 of those years, I had a dog and I walked in the park every day. I'm fairly familiar with the park. The biggest problem with Thomas Square has always been maintenance.
Right.
You walk over by the big banyan tree, it smells like urine. The water, I was very disappointed when you said you're going to replace the pond or the fountain.
Restore.
The fountain, the leaves drop down into the water. They form a stench. Every 2 weeks they come by with large garbage bags, pile them up. There'll be 60 bags around the pool. They'll sit there a few days till they collect them. When the water does come up, it's usually green. It's an embarrassment. And I would hope that either the maintenance is 100% better or you don't put a fountain in, because the fountain is embarrassing. It's so dirty.
Well, and let me address the question. I think maintenance and the ability to keep it maintained is one of the major reasons that we are doing the transfer, because we have the maintenance staff here. Right now, if you go by on a daily basis, if you go to Thomas Square, you know that there's one person there working on a daily basis, and periodically he gets assistance from a roving crew. We are going to be putting significantly more people on the ground and more assets and more equipment at work in there. We're committing, our golf course guys are suggesting that we should be mowing that once a week. I don't know if we're going to be able to commit to that, but we're certainly going to commit to once every 2 weeks or a couple times every 3 weeks. We'll be in there maintaining the grounds to try to keep it the way it looks when it opens. And as for the fountain is going to be restored. We expect it to function as a fountain. I'll let Chris talk a little bit about the banyans and the concept of walking the banyans out, because we're trying to get to a situation where fewer leaves are falling in the water, and we are restoring the area, the rubble really around the fountain, so that it's much easier to maintain, so that we can get the leaves off ideally on a daily basis. But if you can talk about the banyans a little bit.
So for the last 20 years, we've been walking the banyans out of the park, and out of the center of the park, away from the fountain. The way you do that is the aerial roots come down, and when they come down on the inside, we don't allow them to root. When they come down on the outside, we allow them to root. So slowly we're moving the banyan further and further away from the fountain. For 20 years, we've been doing that. In the last 2 years, we've pruned the banyans 3 times to see what we can do. We had a world-class local arborist, my name is Steve Nims, come in, and he actually directed the crews to do the removal so that they removed the most amount they could around the fountain and thinned out the banyans, the amount of leaves. And so the volume of leaves is substantially less than it was 2 years ago. And Steve feels that we've done the most aggressive pruning that we can do at this point, and that's, we feel comfortable with that assessment.
Yes.
You know, there's a major stench, speaking of stenches, that comes out of that manhole cover from the ward and the Veritania. It's in the middle of ward, actually, but that corner of ward and Veritania, could you figure out what that stench is? And it's not all the time.
Yeah, for decades. Forever.
On the corner of Ward and...
Right, in the street, right. Practically.
Yeah.
Right, the manhole.
Cover. In the middle of Baritania.
Yeah.
It's in the middle.
Okay, we can look into that. Okay. Yes.
I live here 63 years. I used to swim in that park. So thank you for redoing it.
So
I won't tell you a story.
One thing I'd mention about the pond is that when the pond was created in 1932, it was pre-air conditioning. It was the favorite place for the community to go because they had the shade of the banyan trees, you had the fountain. And we saw the picture in the beginning. That was a common picture back in those days. When it got hot outside, people would go to the fountain to cool off. And so that comment is a common comment from people that from this neighborhood about the square.
Yes, please.
I have a question about hearing community interest in something so special and important to all of us. Has Adopt a Park ever been a part of a program that exists here so that things like housekeeping and community groups can come and participate regularly to maintain and take care of what you are trying to do?
That's a program that the Parks Department has had for a long time, and they have a large amount of people dedicated to that. I think there are people, like for example, I think Sam and some of his friends have been doing some of that, but I think we can do a lot more of it. So we'll put some information out to see how much we can get done in that regard, because that's the ultimate, is when the people who the park is for take more ownership of the park. Because this park is for everyone. It doesn't matter where you come from, whether you have a house, whether you don't have a house, whether you're rich, poor, white, black, you know, this park is for everyone. That's the coolest thing about parks, is it's the most democratic public space we have. And we'd like to keep it that way.
Yes, please. So the question was, why do we have to close the whole park to do the grass and the irrigation instead of do it in segments?
One of the most expensive costs for a construction project is the mobilization, demobilization of crews. So for example, the first part when you move the grass is a certain set of equipment. And then if they're not going to do it for the whole park, they're going to take that equipment and put it on another project. And they're going to bring it back for the next one. So this will just repeat itself as they go through. The project will take longer. And it will be more expensive. So this is the most efficient way to fix the park. And the park hasn't closed in 49 years, and so this is the first time in 49 years the park's been closed at all. And when we say 6 months, we think that's the maximum. We don't think that's the minimum. So we're going to press hard to get this project done quicker than 6 months.
Yes, please, in the back.
What is the annual cost for the maintenance of the fountain currently? You anticipate after the renovation the cost to be? Also, have you guys also looked into alternatives for replacing the pump with an amphitheater or something? Or?
Parks doesn't itemize costs for maintenance for individual parks. They do groupings of parks, so we don't actually know the cost to, that they spend on maintaining the fountain. But so we don't know those costs at this time. But we're restoring the park, restoring the fountain to its original condition. And if we did remove it, that would be what we, in the SHPD, or historic preservation area, that would be called an adverse effect. And then we'd be entering an EIS, or we'd be trying to do mitigation. And we're trying to keep the park. I think a lot of people identify the fountain with this park. You drive by it, it's the banyans and the fountain. And people all say, that's what makes up Thomas Square. Well, we think that's part of what makes up Thomas Square, and the history is the other part, that the story isn't being told. So we're trying not to have adverse effects, we're trying to avoid that, and we're trying to make sure that the historic elements stay in the park. And the fountain is one of those really iconic elements in this park at the moment.
One of the things, one of the benefits or transferring to enterprise services also allows us to get a better handle on the exact cost of the maintenance of the park. As Chris says, the park is part of a region and they budget by the region, not by park. Yes, in the back.
All the parks here are public trust that they belong to the public. So why are we using taxpayers' money and then turning it over to a private entity? Why is taxpayer money being used? And then why is, well, it's a general use park now. Why is that being narrowed now to exclude and to, why are we losing more rights to be in a public spot?
Thank you. You know, first part of the question, there is no private entity that the park is being transferred to. Department of Enterprise Services is a department of the City and County of Honolulu, just like the Department of Parks and Recreations are. And you might not have been here earlier as I gave the introduction, but Enterprise Services oversees the 22 acres of the Blaisdell Center, as well as other entertainment venues and public venues. And Thomas Square's proximity to the Blaisdell makes much more sense for us to operate it as one facility. But again, to be clear, there is no private entity that's operating the park. The city will continue to operate Thomas Square. And actually, I hope what you see in here is an expansion of the users. I don't think there is really anything that we showed that restricts uses. And as we said early on, in particular to permitted events, all permitted events that take place there right now will continue into the future.
Why are all these rules that are going to apply to that park, the rules that apply to the Shell and to the Neo Blaisdell Center, why is there a narrowing of that? Why is that being lost?
Well, I appreciate you asked that question because it allows me to clarify that we cannot apply Blaisdell rules or anybody else's rules at Thomas Square. It needs to have rules for us to enforce. So if you're looking at what presently happens here on this property, it's not correct to say that is a restriction of what we can do there. We need to go through the rulemaking process, which is a public process, in order to establish the uses. And as I said earlier, we're gonna start with the current park rules that apply in there and go from there and manipulate that to the point where it works and it allows for some of the enhanced kind of programming we'd like to see take place in there. I think you had your hand up right there. Yes, please. Well, I think I can take a shot at it. I think it goes back to what Chris just said in terms of what are the memorable, iconic features of Thomas Square. The pond, the fountain, and the banyan trees, I think, are the things that really come to mind as far as the physical features. So rather than take it out, we plan to restore it, bring it back to, I think, put the luster back on it, as I said before. Well, it's not the only way to enjoy it, so I do hope that most people are going to find the restoration of the fountain as a positive part of the project. It certainly is going to be our intention to have it going all the time as a permanent feature, and again, I think with the additional resources of our department on it, if we do run into periods where for one reason or another it's malfunctioning, I expect that we can get that back online more rapidly. Yes, please.
This hearing, this public hearing we're having, how can it help support your program and push it forward with the mayor and the city council? By us being here tonight and you telling us all about it and answering questions, can it really have an impact on the success?
Well, it absolutely has an impact on the success of the project. And I'd rather be focused on that aspect, that the input that we're getting tonight and that we'll continue to get into the future will help ensure that we can deliver a product that the community is proud of and that the community wants. And I would expect that as we continue this dialogue, the council and everybody else who's watching understands that we are open to the input and we are asking for it at a time where it can still impact the project. So thank you for the question, yes.
Aloha. Mahalo for this master plan. I very much like it. I very much like the fact that you're going to honor Kamehameha III and that you're going to fly the Hawaiian flag. So mahalo for that. I know you will have your challenges. I have some concerns that I would like to address and some questions. So my first question has to do with the position of where Kamehameha statue is and whether you have consulted with those in the Hawaiian community who know cultural protocol about such things as which way statues of our ali'i should face. So that's one question. The second question has to do with, you mentioned that one of your goals is to make this a premier location to hold cultural events. And you have in your scheme there a performance stage. So my question there is, how many do you anticipate would participate or attend such performances? The third is a concern when you have performances, normally you then have commercial entities that serve food. How would that look, and is that a consideration? And the last, and I think for me the most important in terms of outcome and impact, is after this is all done, will there be permit use costs? And if there are today, because I don't know, I haven't gone in for a permit to know, do you anticipate they're increasing? Because a lot of the people who host events now are grassroots, nonprofit organizations, and we just can't afford, as Dr. Ching had indicated, a fee of $4,000 to utilize ELA. Certainly we can't do that. And then the last is Laho Ihoi Eia, as you have recognized, mahalo, that is the most significant event for this park. And I would like to see either in your rules or in city council laws of this city that there is permanent recognition of Laho Ihoi Eia and permanent recognition of the people who have for many recent years voluntarily held that event. Absolutely. It has significantly grown. I was there at the very beginning. It has significantly grown. And for the Hawaiian community, it is absolutely important that we have the ability to continue that event.
Okay, thank you. I know that was a five-parter.
Yeah.
I'm going to start with part five. I think I can still remember part five. What the department will need to do is, as I said earlier, promulgate rules, which is a public process. There's a public hearing requirement, and that's where we can take up these sort of considerations and where that sort of input would probably be shared with us again. So what I appreciated getting it now. In terms of fees, presently there is I think it's $15 of parks levies against certain permitted uses. I anticipate that there will be a fee going forward. We're going to certainly take into consideration what Parks charges now. We certainly won't price it at a point where we don't get the outcome we want, which is more use and more events. Where that dollar amount is, I can't say right now, but I can tell you that process actually is overseen by the council. All of the fees, some of you, it sounds like you may have looked at the city ordinance and you see that our fee structure, All of the fees for the Blaisdell and the rental of any of our facilities are set by council and approved by council. So I would suspect, unless they wanted to allow us to do that by rule, we will be going to the council with amendments to our present ordinance that would have a fee structure for Thomas Square. And in that case, there will be three public readings. So there'll be a number of opportunities for public input into the aspect of how much it might cost to have hold an event there. Certainly what we envision is that any event held there is a free to the public event. And because of that, we certainly understand that we're not gonna charge a fee as if it was a admission event where the organizer could recover any of their costs. I understand that that's not gonna be the case. I think there was also part of the question, excuse me, that had to do with a commercial activity. Presently, yeah. The parks rules allow for commercial activity as long as that commercial activity is conducted by a not-for-profit. I think that's something we will definitely look at. We certainly would like to have food vendors, food trucks, things like that participate and support events that are staged or co-sponsored by us or staged by others in the park. And I'm gonna leave the first two parts to Chris.
The first question about consultation. So we're still going through that process, but those locations are flexible as far as orientation and where the statue and the flagpole is not set in stone at all.
So who might you be consulting with?
I'm working with Misty on that. Misty can go into more detail about that.
Excuse me, I have a question to consider. First of all, I've been a Hawaii resident all my life. And if you are going to enhance Thomas Square and keep the spirit of Thomas Square the same as it is now, I'm for that. What I'm against is, I hope the Hawaii community doesn't hate me for this, but I'm certainly against putting a statue of King Kamehameha or other things. This is perfect like it is, and to enhance it, this is Thomas Square, it's not King Kamehameha Square. And so that's my thing for it. And I would stand by that and fight for that.
Thank you. I certainly appreciate that input. I'd like to ask Ms. Nikolai to come up so we can make sure we answer your question fully. And she can talk a little bit about the process that MOCA has been going through in support of the statue.
I think the way MOCA has should be exact.
Thank you, Limomi, for your question. So, we have a commission on culture and the arts that are comprised of 12 people from the community involved in fine arts, design, landscape, architect, dance, theater, et cetera, et cetera. And all art that we put out qualifications or proposals to the public, they adjudicate all the artists, and then they themselves are artists in all different factions. And we do have a team that studies and does extensive research. On my staff at MOCA, I have our city registrar who maintains our $10 million art collection. He's very akamai, and with the Hawaiian Historic Society, he belongs to several of these organizations, and he works with all of these organizations to make sure that when we receive all the artist proposals or qualifications, that before we send it out to the commissioners to adjudicate, that we ourselves make sure that what we send to our commissioners, these artists are pono and are following our historical and cultural practices. And if we have a, yes?
I am a direct descendant of the Kamehameha line. I do have my genealogy right here, I carry on my dead every single day. I say no.
No to?
No statue.
Where do we put a statue of Kamehameha if not at Thomas Square? He's the longest ruling ali'i. We have nothing in our city art collection or the state art collection. You know, we need to honor him. He did, well, that's state, yeah. We want something, and we're in the capital. I mean, and we feel that Kamehameha, Kawi Keauli, what happened there, what happened with him physically there on that aina, we would honor him and what he did by having his statue there. So when you traverse down King Street, you see Kamehameha Ekahi there. Traverse further down, and you can see Kawi Keauli right there in the park. where Lahoihoeea took place.
I'm sure the part
you put it on the island in Palos Grandes.
Pardon me?
I'm against it because it's a state and not a Hawaiian community. We should honor Admiral Thomas.
Okay, thank you. So I appreciate you reiterating your point, and I certainly we hear your suggestion that the more appropriate place might be Iolani Palace or somewhere else. I think I will also note what Misty had said in terms of this is an attempt for this city to not only do what we want to do here at the park, but also honor the memory of the event that happened there and our significant mo'i associated with the event. So we do feel that is an appropriate place, and we do have the conversation going on in terms of the ultimate final site and selection, but the leading alternative at the moment is viewing from King Street. I'll come here, but let's go right back here first. Please. Yes, thank you.
I just have one thing about the stage. The stage, is it facing for the art academy? Is that what the
orientation of the stage faces toward Veritania, yes.
Right, and so it's going to make everybody sit in the sun. And,
that's an interesting point.
And then they're going to blast the condos. Instead of going this way toward the
shade.
Thank you. We'll follow, we'll comment on that. That actually helps me remember.
I just have one.
Okay, go ahead, I'm sorry. Thank you. Thank you. We'll address both of those in terms of the orientation of the stage and why this was selected. But it also reminds me, I think we didn't answer one question, and that was how many people we thought would be accommodated. So I think Chris can do both of those.
Chairs.
I'm not positive about the amount of folks being here. I can't answer that question. So we'd have to go back and talk to some of the experts at the city to understand how many people fit the square. As far as the stage is a tentative location at the moment. It's all for public comment, so you based on the public comment, we'll go forward with what the public would like to see in the park. So this, like the slide says, it's a draft. Mm-hmm. So that's why we're here tonight, to get your comments and make sure we listen to you folks and get it right the first time.
Okay. Right here, please.
My question is about the fountain. Are we fixed on the current style of the fountain because it has a historical significance? Meaning, is it under the National Historical Committee or conditions that allow for funding or grants that help sustain and maintain that fountain? One, if it is not, there are many fountains that have been presented throughout the state and other states where they are more eco-friendly and they are safer, so that they're cleaner and easier for people to go. Like they have the flat surface where the water shoots up and the children and the people walk back and forth and enjoy the water mm-hmm. feature. When the leaves fall down, they shut the fountain off, they sweep away the leaves. It's a much more easier way to maintain and clean it. You're probably using a better or less water source. Nothing is standing. So those are my two thoughts.
Thank you.
The fountain's called a splashdown fountain. We did look at that actually. And we were thinking about that for this location, but the shade would create, would make it slippery. So the moss would grow. We didn't want to have kids get hurt. So as far as the fountain functioning better, this is an opportunity to look at some new technologies, the way that water is filtered, the way the water gets sucked into the pump and it's pumped back out. And so we're not going to just use the existing equipment. We're going to see if there's some new things that we can incorporate to make it work longer with more leaves in the water. So that's one of the things that we're going to address to make the fountain function most of the time.
Yes.
Most of the homeless that are living in Thomas Square now
a good question.
It's interesting.
Right. Well, thank you. That's that's certainly a very good idea. It's not, I can tell you, it's not one that I had anticipated, because for me, I was under the assumption the park closes at 10 and there's an enforcement on the park closure and nobody's actually living there. But we will.
There's only two that have been living there for years and years.
Right. Okay, I think we can commit to communicating, because we will communicate in advance of the closure to the general public as well as anybody who's actively using it, and certainly offer any services that might be asked for as best as we can. Thank you. Right. I mean, we will go there and see if somebody wants to take advantage of our offer. So, thank you. Yes.
Yeah, I want to ask a question that address some of the questions I've been getting on my live stream. First, I want to say that I'm a regular park user. I participate in an event called Food Not Bombs, which happens every Sunday evening. We feed people, homeless, maybe not, and that sort of thing. It is an unpermitted First Amendment gathering that has happened very regularly since the end of 2011 till now. My question is, what, as the rules change, what can assure us that these kinds of traditional park uses, not only for us, but other people that have this kind of thing, will continue, and it's not an effort just to chase us out?
Thank you. Good question. And I think primarily what prevents that are the checks that's built into the process. And as I said, we have to establish rules for the use to replace the park's rules, and that has to go through a public vetting process. And so that's going to be the opportunity where we hopefully have vigorous debate over how we see the use of the park going forward, but also to answer that question and say our goal truly is to recreate at Thomas Square what the historical record suggests is a vibrant civic center, and in all the different ways you would describe a civic center.
Does that include the uses that it's, the current uses of it, users like us and others that have their friends regularly meet there, have picnics, have that sort of thing?
And again, I think that's our rulemaking process is our opportunity to have a robust discussion about that. So I think it's premature without having a variety, without that being the purpose, and having a variety of different inputs into the
Tell us a little bit about that public rulemaking process. Does that mean having a couple of hearings, or does it go through the city council process, or what?
Administrative rule process is established by statute. So all state departments as well as city departments and divisions have to go through that process in order to create any rules before they can be enforced. The minimum requirement is a public hearing for anybody who has participated in a rulemaking process. Our intention is, as we start to develop the rules, is to take it to the neighboring neighborhood boards, principally neighborhood board 10, which I represent the mayor at, and Sam is on that neighborhood board, I think most people know. Go to the neighborhood board to vet early drafts of the rules before we think it's ready to come bring to the general public hearing, such as one like this, which we have to broadcast. I believe it's 90 days notice. We take input if there are substantive changes to the rules as a result of the public hearing. We have to post another 90-day notice and have another public hearing on it.
Who decides the changes? There's no vote of the people. This hearing is just informational. There's nothing really that the public can do at this meeting to change anything, unless you decide to do so or someone else decides to do so. Is
right.
That correct?
That is the part of the process, and I think that's something that we look forward, going through with the community. So that, we decide at a certain point we think it's ready, but that can't be we can't push it to that conclusion if there's a significant amount of sort of discord over the rule.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
A couple questions. Both of you guys are divisions of the city. One is the parks and recreation, the other is enterprise services, okay? The focus of enterprise services is taking care of like the Shell and NBC, which is like entertainment venues, okay? And you're gonna enhance the park. Why are you transferring from parks to a division that's in charge of entertainment venues?
Oh, yes.
I'm a cynic, you know, a skeptical. It's like, what kind of entertainment are you planning for Thomas Square?
And I think you can describe entertainment in a variety of different ways. I think the Royal Hawaiian Band playing in Thomas Square or Iolani Palace like they do right now is entertainment. But the benefit of the transfer to our department is our ability to support the activity, support the event, whether it is a musical performance, whether it's Kalahoehoe'ea, whether it's powwow. We have the ability, the staffing, and the equipment to be able to support it in a way that's not offered to those events at the moment. So that's, again, that's the primary reason. It's not to stage, for fee acts, shows, and those aren't the purpose. It's, we are developing for ourselves what we're calling the public program for Blaisdell Center, which is comprised of these kinds of events and festivals that we've been talking about. Yes?
When you say support, is it like providing mics and speakers? What level of support are you talking about?
Yes, now we're talking about a level of support that we are right now able to provide for events that we hold on this campus. Whether it's an event that requires tents, whether it's an event that requires chairs, a stage, audiovisual aids, things that we typically would do here, we would be able to support there should an organizer want it to be part of their event. Well, again, I'd say yes, because we need to at least cover our costs, but the fee would be determined by ordinance, which means that ultimately the council would have to approve it. So a significant amount of oversight before a fee is established. Yes, please.
Stage, you said it was facing the Baratanga side. So the way it's set up in the arc outward formation makes sense for perhaps reggae bands or rock bands, but with acts of the Royal Hawaiian Band, they need to arc inward towards the conductor. Would there be enough space on this stage for the Royal Hawaiian Band in its entirety to be able to set up in an arc that moves, I guess, opposite to the one that the stage is set up?
Okay, thank you.
Interesting question.
We met with Clark Bright, the bandmaster for the Royal Hawaiian Band, many times, and this drawing of the bandstand is diagrammatic only. The shape is not determined. This is not going to necessarily be the shape of the end result. And so Clark, we're working with Clark Bright closely to determine if the bandstand is something that's going to be built in the end. If that's one of the things the public wants, then it's going to be made to work for the Royal Hawaiian Band and similar size performances.
Yes, please.
I think this is my last question. We're talking about the way the park will be received and taken care of. How do we operate Queen Kapi'olani Park right now? Were there many events similar or somewhat larger than what you would be doing here, but very much so? Are they under enterprise services also?
Kapi'olani Park, is not under Enterprise Services. Kapi'olani Park is part of the Department of Parks and Recreation. And I think there was a question in the back. Yes, please.
Yeah, looking at trend of general use parks changing into more specialized uses with grass centers like you see on Mobile Home on North America, you see a general kind of restriction usage of it and just rule changing. And I know that you said there's going to be a rule problem. But when you have, like Baron said, a profit-making, venture that goes into safeguarding and protecting the area, is a fundamental conflict of interest. And you have a trend towards exploitation, and you have security showing up there enforcing these capitalist hierarchies. So, and they'll enforce these permits, they'll probably do a lot of, it'll be less freely associated. So that's the trend I see happening. So when you guys take over, I think you take over in phase two, or so you folks take over in phase two, right? Or do you think
No, we should, we should complete the transition and the rulemaking so that we're ready to take over when it reopens after the grass and irrigation project is completed.
February, right?
So that's
February 7th.
That is before phase two. That's part of phase one, February 2017, somewhere in that range, we would expect to have the transfer completed.
And so far, I had a follow-up on that, but that brings up another point with the EIS, with the EAS. You don't think it's a substantive change to cut down, let's say, the Barrow Canyon, that huge tree, that landmark tree, that has probably some monoflorins, and that is a special tree because cats can't climb up it, you know, really, and in the banyans, they can climb up.
Thank you.
That tree is remaining. That tree is not being removed.
On Barrow Canyon?
Yeah, the large one's staying. So all the trees on the project are staying except for a couple that end up being a paved area afterwards.
Yes, please.
I just wanted to say that as a group, Food Not Bond, we don't know of anybody that is living in the park. The park closes at 10 p.m. and under threat of police citation, which already is the law, they can be asked. They're asked to leave, and the police have gone into the park with their cars,
that's right.
And they can enter through on Victoria, and they have
arrested
told people they can't be there after 10 p.m. So nobody is living in the park. Okay.
Please don't go there.
And the other thing I wanted to say is there is a plaque on the stairs that is all from the Daughters of Hawaii that's already commemorating the Lahoi Hoi'ea. So that is there already, and it reinforces that that's a historic state park. And so we want to, you know, we don't want to change the character of that park. That's what we're here.
Thank you.
There already are laws that are applied to that park, and they're being enforced.
Thank you. One more question right here.
I just want to say this. I'm too old to threaten people. I don't threaten people. But I'm going to tell you a fact. You put my family on this park, a statue of him, I will take a chainsaw to your statue. Do not do it.
Well, I appreciate that wasn't offered as a threat. Are there any other questions? Thank you very much for your patience and spending time with us this evening.
We've been at a public hearing about the proposed changes to Thomas Square, which I'm really suspicious of. I think it's being done. They're using public funds, taxpayer money, for the benefit, I think, mostly of tourists. You know what? While you're here, let me move up revenue. So you're right. You're absolutely right. I'm going to put this up here so we get a good look of the, whoops, of course I can't stand in front of it, can I? Oh. Okay. And then I'm going to do a little photo over here. I'm going to post that.
Right.
You can find something that holds it. The 67
everything sitting in the hot sun last
week. It's not a
the master planning funds is start to pay better attention to the sun patterns at the different times of the year.
I had a reasonably sized turnout. Had some political types. No city council members that I could see. We had the mayor's rep, used to be a reporter. We had the Parks and Rec guy who's in charge of the redesign. We had the head of enterprise services, which takes care of the Blaisdell Center and that sort of thing. They did not present all this to the neighborhood boards, of which Sam Mitchell here is a member of, the one in Makali Mo'ilili Makiki, I'm sorry. So that was a concern. There were no city council members here. There is a council meeting, full council meeting over the budget, I believe, tomorrow. So we'll see. They claim, these guys, the city guys, the enterprise services guys, claim that there is enough money, and that it's already part of the deal. So I'm gonna.
So that's you guys that do that little potluck looking thing in the corner
what we do.
Of
that's what
is
do.
It, Ward and Baratania.
Ward and Baratania.
I've seen that. I thought that was cool.
Supposed to be vegetarian. You know, you can bring whatever. Supposed to be. That's what people break the rules. And sometimes we say, you know, chicken is a vegetable some days. And then we have free books, and then people bring, like, you know, if you got articles of clothing or blankets, anything like that. Free stores. And no propaganda, we just, you know, and then we play music like that.
Yeah, I've seen that. I got off you like late afternoon kind.
Afternoon, evening into the evening.
Yeah, I've gotten off. I walked across the street. A friend of mine lives up the road.
So
I was just gonna go hang out with him, and I walked by. It was cool.
Yeah, we had music. Yeah. So, you know, we've had Lico Martin play down
there. Yeah, a couple guys jamming.
Yeah, jam music.
That was cool.
I play music, guitar.
I thought it was interesting. That's a good thing.
Yeah, you can drop by, say hello next time. Sure. Sunday, I'll be there. Alright, thanks. Sorry about the problems with the. We love these things. New camera. We take pictures. You know everything that's going on. We can shoot. You know, I'm live video. I know this guy. He's at the corner on Sunday too. Sometimes. You're wearing your good clothes. So. you're wearing the Al the journalist clothes. Thank you.
Yeah, precisely. I was in my.
Thank you for your question. I'm putting this in your
Well, bank. The second question that I asked was not answered. The first part was kind of answered.
Yeah.
The second was not.
Yeah.
They kept going to the aspect. My point was, why bother if you're not going to do a complete change to the park?
Yeah.
Why do you bother to do it if you're going to do a statue here and then work
and
on the edges?
Nobody asked for this. I don't want it. Nobody wants it. Why are we spending public money on, like,
well,
what might be like a
that's
tourist.
That's the other part I asked about appropriations.
Yeah.
It's not a fully funded project. In
that's
either
right.
This fiscal year or 2017, they say one phase is.
Well, he's saying it's already in the budget somewhere.
But you got
at
opposition
part.
On the city council.
Yeah,
you
do.
You clearly
there's
have
a meeting tomorrow, I was telling people.
Yeah, because I saw a news report. I saw a news report before I came here about this meeting.
Right, right.
This, and it is clear opposition from city council members.
Right, right.
There's no way that this is a done deal. What's
that's
happening
right.
here
they're
now,
selling it as though it's a
precisely.
Done deal.
Precisely.
Or at least the phase one.
They're selling it as if they have most of what they need. Okay, these are public comments.
Right.
That's what it's being done here. I see what this game is. I mean, you know, that's why I ask the questions. They go to the heart of this.
Yeah.
You don't have the appropriations entirely funded. You know, what are you going to do about that? You only got one phase completed.
Thank you, Al. What name are you going under nowadays?
Well, you could go to Albert Lanier on
Facebook. Albert Lanier.
Yeah, that's my journalist. Lanier. So.
Very good.
That's it. But, you know, that's my point. They don't have the funding for it.
Right.
The second question that I asked, they're asking about the edges and all of that.
Yeah. Yeah. And the whole rulemaking process, they can make any damn rule they want, basically, is what they say.
But also, the fact, I didn't get into the fact that they had separate meetings here. I was tipped off that they had, I guess, supposedly a meeting for condo
They canceled that meeting. That was supposed to be this past Friday.
Yeah, there were a couple.
There was one before that week, for right? Permit holders. There is a live stream of
it. There were a couple of meetings that I was tipped off.
Right.
And I guess what you said one was
For permit holders. So there was a groups of people, powwow guys, Lahoihoi, actually they didn't show up in that one. Food Not Bombs, which is not permitted, and I think it's important that it's not permitted. You know? We don't need no stinking permit. We're people doing what the people do. We're the public.
Right. Interesting. Unpermitted, yeah. I thought about that.
And it is vegetarian, but sometimes we nominate like chickens to be vegetables. Sometimes we've done that before.
But like I said,
anyway,
the necessity of this project is questionable.
Yeah, it's not necessary for the public. That's for damn sure. Let's see. I'm gonna walk over here. There's Oren, who's usually shooting at these things. That, I believe, is Andrew Pereira, right? He used to be a reporter, now he's like the mayor's propagandist. Anyway, that's pretty much it. So I might back up all the way here. I'll back my way out and end my live stream. Thanks for joining us. I was getting monster bandwidth. You know, I think live stream is under pressure from Periscope and Facebook Live to increase their bandwidth allocations. I was getting up to 1.7 megabit per second flow, which is explains some of the
heard.
You know, that if they're gonna call for Discord,
yeah, we will bring it.
We'll bring it. You know, we can't let them change rules and like chase people out of the parks and stuff.
Well, you
like
see, what did the security guard do?
Yeah, I caught him on. Yeah.
It's like, come on, you got this attitude.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks for joining us. And that was Sam Mitchell. Thank you, Sam. What are you going to... You know, I have a question for you. Because sure. They were talking about bringing things to the neighborhood board. Now, I heard there's... that they want to abolish the neighborhood board system. Does that come from the mayor? Or where does that come from?
They don't want to hear discussions like this.
Yeah.
They feel that they can get it all by computer and internet, Facebook. So... that's the big problem, because if they think they can do this, then they don't need these meetings.
They don't need these. They can do away with the meetings and just do what they want.
Right, and have no input at all.
They don't like being grilled by people like
yes,
you, I think.
They don't like, this is a long, drawn-out process.
Yeah.
And you need to hear a whole bunch of people to come up with a good decision.
Yeah.
And you can't do that on the internet.
You can't do that. So you think they'll be successful in this?
I don't think so.
Whose plan was that? Who suggested that?
It came from the... The city charter commission.
Oh.
They're gonna put it on the ballot. But the problem is the way they have it worded, it sounds like they're doing a good thing, trying to modernize the communication. But in reality, what it is shutting back information. So I'm very concerned. The people that sit on the charter commission are all political people, maybe kind of political hacks. And they're pushing it because they want to have more control of what things that happens in the city.
Oh my God.
And the best way to do that is to get rid of the activists and just let the money speak.
Yeah, even louder, more loudly. Thanks, Sam. We're going to keep that from happening.
Thank you.
Okie doke. So I promise that's it. That's it for now. Thank you.